Our laws as it pertains to substances are draconian and bizarre. The psychopaths start this way.
He was an alcoholic because of social media and pornography, PTSD,
love addiction,
fentanyl and heroin.
Ridiculous.
I'm a doctor for sake. Where the hell do you think I learned that?
I'm just saying, you go to treatment before you kill people.
I am a clinician. I observe things about these chemicals.
Let's just deal with what's real.
We used to get these calls on Loveline all the time.
Educate adolescents and to prevent and to treat.
If you have trouble you can't stop and you want help stop it, I can help.
I got a lot to say. I got a lot more to say.
And I will be taking your calls, but I want to get right to my guest, TV, radio personality, co-hosted Good Day LA for years, Fox NFL Sunday. She's been on everything, Mad TV, Clueless. She had a radio show along myself on KBC here in Los Angeles, the great Jillian Barberie. Jillian, welcome. And now,
a
new podcast called Ask Jillian.
That's right. And you ask me anything. I just, you know, we talk about whatever, everything, and love it. I love... just sort of that freedom, you know? And you know, ABC is so great with radio. It just gives you that freedom. I don't think that TV does somehow.
And radio doesn't either, in the sense that radio, you have program directors and you have producers and you have engineers and you have a tower that's submitting the, you know, pushing the signal out.
Signal.
It's just you with the podcast.
My God, I know it's a whole other ball game. But you know, I think that when you go through things in life, you have more to talk about, you know.
Yeah.
So yeah, we a cancer episode, or we'll do a comedian, or a musician, or somebody who's in the health field like yourself. And I find some people that are not really well known. I'm so interested in everything they have to say, if they've written a book, because when I got cancer, when I was first diagnosed, I wasn't one of those people that said, oh, let me get a second opinion, chop them off, let's go. What about here? When could I do chemo? Like, I attacked. And it wasn't like maybe a year after that, whoa, I worked through all that. And I took care of the two kids, and it really hit me. It's a whole other, and then I went into like a depression about it. It was very strange.
Well, you were sort of
on the other side.
You were in survival mode there for a while, right?
Yes.
You just doing what you had to do, and then you had the effects of the chemo brain, and the stress, and the uncertainty, yes. And the kids, and radio. Oh, we had to deal with all the radio bullshit we were dealing with at the time. Remember?
Yeah. Yes, of course. And then in the middle of all of it, they syndicated. You and I were gone essentially, and I was like, oh my God, that's my job. I have two kids full time, you know, I don't get child support. So I was having a meltdown mentally inside, and I think that's what led me to the depression. Like, just sort of, okay, now I'm on the other side of cancer, what now? And
yeah.
So it's a roller coaster, but it's one that, you know, you go through, you get through it, and you move on. I mean, what else can you do? I had two kids at the time, you know, I still do, but they were 10 and 12, and I had no choice but to be there for them and try not to scare the shit out of them. Like,
right.
I would literally go to my shower and have a meltdown, but then I would come out and I'd be like, it's all good, you know? It's fine.
Oh, my God.
It's your boobs.
That's awful.
Know? Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, and my son now, he's 11, and he says that I don't really have boobs because he's like, he calls me robo boobs because I don't have nipples. Oh, there he is. And there's implants now. So he's like, those aren't real. Like, they're not real boobs. And I'm like, you're kind of right, but most of all, he has fake boobs. But
hey, by the way, I mean, Jillian, Susan's leaning into the mic here too, but Susan, I think I don't know if you know this, but she was I was one of the first to see the results of the plastic repair.
Oh.
Yeah, she was very proud of everything.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, gosh, yeah. I think I showed you, and I may have shown Steve Edwards.
Yeah.
But it's because I've known you guys so long, and
Steve was actually there. It was Steve and I in the room, I believe.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, they did a wonderful job, and it's healed beautifully. Like, I have very little scar. And everyone's like, oh, you should tattoo nipples and this and that. I'm like, oh, my God. It's so much work. And for who? Who am I doing that for? It's not like I'm dating anybody out of my bra. I'm like, hey. But it's been kind of nice not to have to wear a bra, because I did wear one for all those years, because I did have real boobs. I know a lot of people think burnt. And so it's been very nice not to have to worry about that. But I will say it's a very strange to have like a foreign object in your body. And after my, I want to mention to people out there going through cancer, I had radiation therapy. Radiation therapy, yeah. And it made one of my my right one where I had the cancer like hard as a rock. So I you know, I'm like, Rocco, punch it here. Look how hard it is. It's like a wall. No, I won't. As he sits over there watching me. But anyway, yeah. So I'm just glad that that journey is behind me, and I would call them Frankenboobs, but I only showed, maybe you and Steve were the only men that I've ever seen, and to this day. So, you know.
Well, they did. I was so happy you were pleased, which was nice, how people, you were in the hands of a surgeon that I know people end up very happy afterwards.
Oh, thank you. And it's funny because when I had mentioned that I was working, because they're like, oh, we don't see you on Good Day LA. Where are you? And I said, oh, actually, I work at KBC. You know, Dr. Drew's there. They're like, Dr., oh, my God, we've known him for years. We love him. Yeah. And then you had told me the name of the surgeon. You said, oh, she's fantastic. So I felt good about going in and just doing it all at once. I didn't want to have two surgeries. So
I'm telling you the team that you had does that, and it's really – kind of remarkable how much good that does for people to wake up and things are reconstructed and they feel good about things. Yeah. So how are things now? What's the current situation? Are you PET scanning every year or are you? Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks for asking that. Surgeon oncologist, is that a surgery oncologist? Mm-hmm. And so she gave me a, like an echogram type thing. And she said, I'm completely fine. She was, you know, I did have lymph node cancer. So she was concerned, would back into my lymph node. She took 18 and 16 of them were cancerous. Can you guys hear me?
Yes. You're doing a little little bit of max headroom.
Oh, no. So anyway, all is good. I'm in remission and I feel really, really good about that.
Good. That's good. But are they monitoring you once a year, once every 6 months? What's their sort of pattern?
Yeah, once a year. I was telling Susan earlier, I said, my God, when you do the double mastectomy or whatever I had with the chemo and radiation, they put me for 5 years and it's called letrozole. It puts you into full on, because I wasn't in menopause. Like I was just...
Now you are.
I was a late bloomer.
Now you are.
Honey, it is so disgusting. It's like I'll have a shower and then I come out and I feel like I need another shower. It's just, it's like if you work, you remember how, you know how Howard always talks about Peloton and I can't get off and he feels gross and he has a shower and then he feels gross. That's how I feel all the time. Yeah. And it's just, it sucks. It really does. But what's the other? I mean, I don't have one. So, you know, it's fine. It's fine with me.
That's right.
How are you doing physically? You're feeling okay?
No, I'm nowhere near myself. I went and saw patients this morning. It's very weird. Oh, the post-COVID is very weird. I'm a month tomorrow. It's been three weeks on my back. And I started getting around last week. And I can do stuff, but then I have to lie down. It's just weird. Like I went and saw patients this morning. I saw two patients and I thought, oh my God, I have many more and I'm not going to get through this. And all of a sudden I got some energy and I was through it and I felt good. And I, you know, saw a bunch of people and then came home and then crashed. And then I'd lie down now I'm feeling okay again. It's just very weird. It's just not fun.
No, the people that know what you're talking about and that your voice is just a tinge different. And same with my girlfriends. When I talk to them on the phone, I'm like, they said, can you hear it? I said, I can hear it. It's not the breathlessness. It's just a little bit of a hoarser voice. And they said it knocked them on their, knocked them on their ass. And they were the same thing in bed. It's tough. It really is.
But brutal.
Susan was excited that you were on your back for 3 weeks. That was the,
that made her very happy. Made her very happy. After about 2.5 weeks, I had to send her away.
Because you have no idea that she has energy for days, and her and I do talk about you sometimes, which makes me laugh because I don't have energy. That.
Yeah, the note, all of a sudden, so my energy is something that's been a issue in our relationship, because it's like it overwhelms her, it makes her anxious and stuff. And now that it's went away, she wasn't so happy. Wasn't as happy as she thought she'd be with me without energy.
You can't win. Oh my
right.
God, that's
Thank
hysterical.
You. Thank you. Let us take some calls. We're taking calls at 984-237-3739. Got a bunch of people already queued up here. So this is a caller who I think used to call us on KBC all the time. Is this Nicole from San Diego?
It is, Dr. June. It is the Nicole from San Diego. It's so good to hear you guys together again. And Jillian, I'm so happy about your remission.
It's good.
Oh, thanks, Nicole. Thank you so much.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we hear you. We got you.
And we hear you beautifully.
Yeah. Okay. And part, actually, that reminded me of part of my story. So, Dr. Drew, keep in mind that in my family, you're talking to the half that is not medical. So I'm going to do my best, okay?
Okay.
So the thing that I had put up, my dad is a pediatrician. He is 79 years old. Mm. A matter of fact, he beat, let's see, lymphoma. He started treatment September of last year, or I guess a year ago, and was done and cancer-free in February. Instantly, very careful. He still worked, so he was very stubborn about not seeing patients, but with the shutdown, he had to. Very cautious. Thanksgiving, he has something go weird with his eye. Mm-hmm. He has to go into the emergency room.
Uh-oh.
It's a show, like you said, a stuff show.
Yep.
He's there for 8 hours, and a few days later, he has COVID.
Brutal.
So I'm not, so he gets COVID. He gets diagnosed Monday. He gets the treatment, the antiviral.
This is now November.
That's all he gets, and I was, this is November.
And he gets the monoclonal antibodies?
He wasn't going to ask for him. He has been in practice for 40 years. And a matter of fact, he ended up in a wing that he opened a PQ in Walnut Creek at John Muir. So somebody got word that he was sick, and an infectious disease guys came, and he got one of the three treatments.
Okay.
So, but that was it, right? And so he starts to get better, and, he's got the cough and all that. So come about 2 weeks ago, he is doing terrible. My sister's a nurse down here in San Diego. Oh. She goes up there. His oxygen is 83.
Oh, boy.
He was a terrible patient. He hadn't been taking it. 83. Yeah. So he goes back into the hospital, and he's very, very, very sick. And the treatment is terrible again. But then a couple of days later, he has both the antiviral.
So he gets
getting live.
So he gets remdesivir this time, right?
Well, not right away, but my sister's a nurse, got privileges up there and went up there, and yes, he did. Now, with the cancer, his kidneys were an issue.
Oh, yeah, the remdesivir can affect the kidneys.
Right.
All right.
But everything was day by day.
So, Nicole, let me get the timeline right. The original illness was in November?
Yes, around Thanksgiving.
And did he come all the way back? Was he 100%?
No.
He never came back.
No, no matter if, and he went and saw patients also, and he is a pediatrician.
Oh, wow.
And what was he experiencing?
Amazing.
Before he got sick again, what was he experiencing? Fatigue, cough, that kind of stuff?
Yes, a lingering cough, and a man like you who has, limitless energy, he still skis, all that stuff, he was exhausted.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So I don't know what to make of that, whether that's a recurrence or a reinfection, right? As I've talked about here, I'm going to be monitoring my immunity to try to decide when to get the vaccine. Did he get the vaccine at any point?
No, we were so close to it.
Yeah. Awful.
I mean, that's what's frustrating.
Yes.
He'd been so careful. We had not seen him.
Yeah.
And he had to go to the emergency room because his eye, it was just not good. He thought maybe he had a brain tumor.
Oh, boy.
And
that's the
only place he went.
Hmm.
I know.
Nicole, that's
so
a lot
have
for
you
a
heard
man.
Of reinfected? With,
yes. Yes.
And he is Superman. Okay,
yes.
That's
so here's, but now, I've never heard in a reinfection at such a close time interval. I've heard it reinfections at 6 months. And it's why it made me want to be more conservative with my own management. I mean, I don't want to take a vaccine that I don't need, but I will take the vaccine at the point at which my immunity starts to drop off. But his is so recent. His original infection was so recent. You got to wonder if it's some sort of weird recurrence, but who knows? I mean, it's unless you're monitoring these things, it's very hard to tell. But I'm so sorry he's doing poorly. That
sucks. I guess they are. The infectious disease people came in, so they are taking his case. So we will learn more. Before I get off the phone on a different subject, Mayor Faulkner, who is a former mayor now, is, I think he's thrown his hat in for governor.
I heard that.
Mayor of San Diego.
And he, Jillian, did you get a chance to talk to him when he came up to KBC?
No, I did not.
San Diego is the only city in the state that's actually doing something about homelessness. It's because of him. He went in, looked at what the problem was, understood it, went, okay, let's change this, and did. And he's a really nice guy.
He did, and I have one of them. I have one of his success stories at our place right now, who was in the convention center, a homeless guy, got all the wraparound services, is now clean, and he is a joy in my life. And it is because of what Faulkner. So you know how I feel about him? He is a neighbor, so if you want to throw any support, I don't know if I can leave my number, but I am going to be campaigning for this man.
Oh, I think I would do the same if we get to that point. I really am impressed by him. So,
leave your number.
I can put you in touch with him.
Please, I told him that back when I interviewed him about 2 years ago. I said, you need to.
I called.
Yeah, I remember that. That's right.
So after that, I accosted him. I accosted him and said, you heard Dr. Drew. And he said, yes, I did. And he said, let me finish up my term first. That's a good man.
Yeah.
He said, before I think about it, let me finish my term here for San Diego.
Nicole, leave your number and I'll get in touch with you, right?
He'd be good for us.
Leave your number. Okay.
Okay, you'll put me back on with somebody?
Yes, I hope so. I hope they're listening. Caleb, can you help me with that? Okay, Susan's got on it. Jillian, here's a call for you.
Thank you, Nicole.
Yeah, thanks, Nicole. This is, I'm not sure what the name is, like structure? Is that right?
It's structure. It's a nickname I got in college because I did a presentation and I misspelled structure. Broke my balls, you know, for the next 25 years. I have a 79 IQ, so bear with me.
Yeah, Eric,
Jillian,
is this you?
Jillian, we at Radio Gunk and Gary Puppet are so effing proud of you for what you've gone through, for what you've accomplished. The worst thing to ever happen to Fox, besides the cancellation of 21 Jump Street, was losing you on the weather, and you know that.
I agree. They had a dream team and they just dismantled it.
Still don't know why. Exactly. I had Dorothy on my podcast. Dorothy came on and I said, "Do you know why we were shit canned?" And she's like, "No." And then I said, "I don't know why either." So we still have no clue. But Fox will tell you they didn't shit can me. They offered me 3 days a week, which they did, but it wasn't on the desk anymore. It was to be out a reporter in the field. And I'm like, I'm not a fucking reporter. What am I going to do out there? And they're like, oh, do anything you want. You can go skydiving. You can go to the roller derby. I don't give a shit. And I said, no, I can't. I won't do it. I've been here for 20 years sitting in this chair.
I always looked at it like you were to the NFL broadcast what Holly Robinson was to 21 Jump Street. Cannot go without it. The heart and soul of the show. Yeah.
So you're also
that is a very big compliment.
I gotta tell you guys,
go ahead.
We're all Stern fans. I have to ask Jillian here. Jillian, why, by the way, Gary Puppet, you have to call Gary Puppet. He is, if Howard conceptualized Millie Bobby Brown and the Olsen twins, you have to get Gary Puppet. I mean, it can't be any less cute. But I want to ask you, Drew, psychoanalyzation-wise, and Jillian, I know you're psychologically acute as well, do you believe Howard is a sociopath for firing Scott the engineer when his wife got cancer? I mean, you know him better than I do. Why he doesn't have Jillian on the show anymore is maybe more of a crime than to the NFL. But
Howard, let me be. Let's be clear. Howard, not
what's
a sociopath.
I mean, have either of you ever met Marcy Turk?
No.
Yes. And oh, you haven't, Drew. I did.
Have you, Jillian? You did the red carpet. You did the red carpet, Jillian, for Howard's birthday bash that they spent millions of dollars. By the way, I believe Howard had Jason Ellis, Jenny McCarthy, and the bonfire fired so they could rationalize paying him on a new contract.
Wait, Jillian, you did the red carpet for them.
For his.
Wait, back up. I didn't know Jenny was fired. Oh, I didn't know that. Okay. Yep. Yes, I did the red carpet, but that's not when I met Marcy.
I met Marcy.
Yeah, I love Jenny. I haven't seen Jenny in a long time, but
Do you think it's a coincidence that all three of those shows got whacked the day they signed Howard to a new contract, which he probably doesn't deserve? I've heard from Tim Sabian he has less than 200,000 listeners on a good day.
Now, wait a minute.
So how you can? He makes $4,000 a minute.
All right. Look, they're a business.
Drew, I got it.
Hang on. From my perspective, Sirius is a business. I've talked to Jason Ellis about this too, who does agree with you. That's probably what happened. But they're a business.
Yeah.
The cornerstone of their business is the Stern Show. A lot of people buy those subscriptions because of Stern. A lot. I'm sure they just did the math, and this is the way the math worked out.
Drew, they won't release the numbers. That's what they tell you. They will not release subscription numbers. You notice it never. There's no rating system.
I understand.
He signed a deal with the devil. I believe Howard's a silent partner, and he has a right to refusal every 5 years. And he's actually a silent partner, and he makes these decisions. So they offer him this.
I don't know. You know what? You're talking to two of the biggest Howard Stern fans. I've listened to him for 30 years. He is the best at what he does. I don't give a shit if he makes $100 million a year. He's fucking worth it because he's Howard Stern.
Yeah, that's kind of the way I feel. Yeah.
I don't give a shit. Like, he is the reason that Sirius is
Say it again.
It's like saying HBO, like Game of Thrones. Everybody watched it that I knew, but you don't have a barometer. Bill Maher, I watch him every Friday night. There's no barometer. They get paid money. It is what it is. Is he supposed to say no to it? Now, Bob the Engineer story, I did get a lot of people asking me about that because she had cancer. And I had no inside information. To get back to Marcy Church, my last visit to the Stern Show, I think it was five years ago, and Marcy came right up and she was very direct and she was like, "Hi, I'm Marcy Turk." And I said, "Oh, wow. Okay. Hi." I knew she was a big deal. And I think that, you know, for some people, Howard's evolved and they want Butt Bongo Fiesta still. They don't want, you know, Paul McCartney for an hour and a half or Hillary Clinton for 2 hours, which I thought was fucking amazing. But I like it all. I loved when he had Jenna Jameson on. I loved when he had Tabitha Stevens. And I love when he has politicians, and I love when he has musicians. So I'm like you, Drew, where he can make anybody interesting or funny. So I don't care. I feel he's worth the money. Yeah. I don't know any of the backstory, though. I didn't even know about Jenny. I had no idea. No idea. But she's still, isn't she on the board? She's still got jobs, so she's okay.
Yeah. But she's got the Masked Singer and stuff. But her show was very good on Sirius. And so, of course, Jason had a huge following, but he's doing okay now with the podcast, the awesome podcast. Everybody check that out. I'm going to be on it next week. Yes.
Oh, you are?
Drag my ass down. Yeah.
Oh my God. You have to go down there.
Oh, wait, Susan's here. Comes Susan.
It's going to be really fun.
Uh-oh.
Really? Why?
Surprise. Oh,
no. There's a surprise.
Yes.
Shit.
Oh my God. Do I have the energy for this?
Yeah, you'll be fine.
I have a question. Do you have to actually go there? Can you do it through Zoom?
He's making me go down.
You don't have to have sex with him or anything.
They do it in Hermosa. And they're I think I'm gonna play George Takei for the day.
Shut up. You're going to be like judging penises and stuff?
I hope not. I certainly hope not.
Something.
But
isn't it amazing, though, like all the people that have like the ideas that, you know, this and that and the conspiracies about Stern, it's just such an anomaly. It's such a, you know, he's a game changer. He's a pioneer and that's what you get with that.
You and I have been there many, many times and we know it's a radio show. It's a great team. They're just doing their job. Amazing. You know what I mean? They're creating a great show every day, and it's a lot to it. Yeah. There's a lot of moving parts, and there's a lot going on. And the
I don't think people realize how much goes on behind the scenes, how many people they have involved in that show. It is a, just what you said, it's a well-oiled machine.
Giant operation. Yeah. Yeah, and it creates a great product, and God bless him. He's the brains behind
it. God bless him.
He's the reason for
it. Can I tell you, do you get the annual Stern Christmas card?
I don't think I do.
Okay, so each year, okay, it used to be Howard, you know, taking pictures with this cute animals, and she'd have these calendars. Then it was Howard. He would take his own, because he was into photography. He would take pictures of himself with Beth and maybe an animal, right? So then he started to take painting lessons, and you know him, he's full throttle. It has to be 100% or he doesn't, you know, he's like, well, I'm not doing it.
Right.
He starts painting, and I get a card last year, and I'm like, well, that's a beautiful painting of this cat.
I think we got one at one time, was a rose or something, a flower.
This year, can I just tell you, I opened it up and I started crying because aww. A, I love him so much, but B, he took this picture. He says it's a road. It's this country road outside of upstate New York, I guess. And it's the tall grass and a barn, and the detail looks like it was ridiculous. And he's so fucking talented. I'm like, what can't he do? You know, I don't know.
Right.
Maybe sing. Yeah. That's the one thing he wanted to be a rock star, but he is a rock star of radio. And to the last caller, I don't think it's that they wouldn't have me on. I mean, Gary will shoot me emails and just say, you know, how you doing? I'll talk to Ralph all the time.
I got to call Ralph. Like
they don't. Yeah, yeah. And Ralph's doing great. Yeah. Ralph and I talked about, you know, the whole election and how he was mad at Ronnie. Like, I love the inner workings of that show, you know.
Yeah.
Because Ronnie wouldn't say who he was voting for. It was so fun. And so I don't feel like, you know, oh, I'm not allowed on it. It is what it is, you know. Like, if they're having A-list celebrities, that's great. But if I have something to promote and maybe he wants to talk about recovery of cancer, maybe, you know, I can go on again at some point.
Well, you can certainly go on the after show anytime you want, I'm sure. So
I love when you're on there too, because just as an insider, you know so much, you get to add, you know. They were having some people on there that weren't super fans like us. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to drive my car off the road. I'm like, she doesn't even know that reference. Why am I not on? You know,
she doesn't know who High Pitch Eric is? What?
Yeah,
the temerity.
Yeah, so I love the after show. It's great. I think that John Hine and Gary do a really great job. But Howard, he's worth the next 5 years. I'm so happy he resigned.
Yeah, which is nice. And so is Marianne. She went nuts. All right, let's take another call here. This is Julia. Hi, Julia. Uh-oh, she went back. Hold on, she went back.
No.
Did she drop? Is that what happened?
I guess. Are you hung up on her?
I don't know what that category is she's in.
She's terminated calls. You can call her back. Push call back. See what happens.
I don't know what that does.
Call back.
It's just happened.
Might get her voicemail.
Shoot. Wow. All right. Well, there you go. It just dropped. I screwed that up. But anyway, let's go.
If we hang up on you, call back.
So other than the podcast, anything else you're up to these days?
So, you know, with everything going on now with COVID, normally I would go to Canada and visit my parents. They're also 79. My dad's 82. And so, you know, we couldn't do that this year. It was just me and the kids. And I'm sort of figuring out what's next.
Have reached the voicemail box of this.
Hold on. There we go.
Keep going. And so I'm
getting dropped.
Doing the podcast. What's happening? Is it me?
No.
It's true.
So yeah, I'm trying to. I'm just basically figuring out my next step, you know, and for the longest time, health was my number one. It's like, I don't care what's happening and anything else but health, because you could be the richest man in the world. And I know the woman who's dating him, by the way. And if you don't have your health, what does it matter? Right? Like what do you have? Who gives a shit how much money you have if you don't have your health? So it's really, it slowed me down and it put things into perspective.
I also had a really weird, I've talked about it before on this stream, emotional experience lying there sick. I thought to myself, okay, I'm glad this happened to me. I can at least share now a patient perspective. I can help people.
Ah.
And I will happily take this bullet if it means that other people can live. You know what I mean? But I thought, I was lying there thinking, oh, wait a minute, people can't live. Their businesses are being closed. They're being just crushed by their governments. That was the most disturbing thought when I was lying there sick. I just thought that at least if I get the bullet and so everyone else can live, I'll take it. But oh no, everybody else being prevented from living also, how awful.
So it
was really not a good feeling, I gotta tell you.
I can only imagine, and especially being in the health care providing system like you are. You're a frontline worker and you're at the hospital and you're seeing it and then you get it. And it's like, I can only imagine the craziness. My neighbors now are over 65, and so they finally, you know, are on a list. They have an appointment time. Yeah. So,
well, now the real craziness is the hospital stonewalled me from getting the vaccine. I would like to go I would like to go volunteer in the ER, but I don't have the stamina to do it now. I can't do it. I can't do more than about two or 3 hours of work. They want an 8-hour shift. I can't, just can't, physically can't. So here now they're complaining they don't have staff, volunteer staff ready to go if they had just spread the vaccine out to the medical providers, which they did not. And the same is thing with the 65 plus. These are the people that have the most to gain from the vaccine. Speaking of the vaccine, let's we have a call here. Somebody wants to ask.
Don't hang up on her.
Question about the vaccine. Don't hang up on Jillian.
Sean.
Oh, Sean. Hey, Sean. What's going on?
Hey, Drew. How are you?
Yeah, I'm all right. Been better, but okay.
I have a 17-year-old daughter who works in a medical office, and she has had coronavirus already and recovered. And they are requiring her to get the vaccine. And you know, ahead of 65-year-olds also, which seems silly, but...
That seems insane.
What are your thoughts on that?
How long ago did she have the illness?
It's insane.
How long ago did she have the illness? Well, not totally insane yet. Let's see.
3 weeks ago, she tested negative and went back to work.
Even Fauci said you shouldn't get it for 90 days. So she can refer to the CDC.
Really?
Anthony Fauci says 90 days. And... And she can get I got this thing called Aditic Score. It's a company I work for. But you can get antibody levels. If you want to just get general antibody levels, she can have her blood drawn. Or she can do this thing called Aditic Score. Where do they sign up, Susan?
DrDrew.com/Aditic.
No. It's AditicScore.com. A-D-I-T.
No, I don't have the thing in front of me.
We have a full screen for it somewhere. Mm-hmm. But it look up. What I'm going to do is have the Aditic Score done every month. I'm going to have another one done in about a week. And it's when my
DrDrew.com/score.
Okay, try that. It's a very accurate way to follow immunity and to prove you're immune. And then if you start falling, then you get the vaccine. But you know, by the time her immunity falls off, they'll be. I don't want to say safer, but there'll be vaccine alternatives that are more appropriate for her age. Let's put it that way. The Novavax will be out. The Johnson & Johnson will be out. And yes, then she should take it, but not immediately if you can avoid it. I don't hear you. I need her mic on.
Right, yeah. I'd rather she... The whole risk-reward thing is, there's no risk for her.
That's right. There's no risk for the illness, right. But there may be a theoretical risk from the vaccine. By the same token, if you're 65 and above, the risk of the vaccine is nothing compared to the risk of the illness. So, what did you say about hospitals, Susan?
Hospitals are telling people to get it within a month, because even if they've had it.
Why?
I don't know. The dermatologist told me that. And that's...
No sense.
It's such a waste. It's like there's people that need it, you know.
That's the craziest thing ever to me.
I mean, 90 days even seems soon to me.
It is soon, but I understand why he would say that. He's always very conservative in his recommendations, and so
I have a question. If my kids got COVID, they couldn't do anything because they're under 16, correct? Is it 16 and above?
Correct.
Okay. Interesting.
It would be like getting a runny nose.
And let's how did the illness manifest with your daughter?
She was sick for one day, and a mild, it was the COVID symptoms. I mean, she had a fever and cop, and you know, she spent her 2-week quarantine period body surfing and ice blocking, and she was out. She was fine.
Hey, Sean, can I ask you a question?
Yeah, I don't know. It's,
can we bring my 77-year-old housekeeper there in her place and just show them who needs the damn vaccine? I can't get one for her.
Really?
Yeah.
You have trouble signing up?
I can't.
There's like so many. There's so many reasons why she shouldn't get it. You know, the ethical and the need and
right. Benefit. So I'm gonna put words in your mouth. The ethics are you have a 17-year-old taking a vaccine away from a 65-year-old. That is ethically untenable. Yeah,
I can.
The ethics are bad. The operational aspect. There are more sophisticated ways to do it by monitoring her immunity. The fact that my son had COVID, I transmitted to one person, and it was my son in the household here where we are locked down, which is where it normally transmits. One person, and he got it, and he's refusing the vaccine because he said, "Why? If I get this thing again, who cares?" It was nothing for him. And so, you know, if you're young, it tends to be nothing. I'm not saying, and those of you on the stream, don't tell me about your 20, 30, or 40-year-olds that have long hauler syndrome or you heard about a case that died in Wisconsin. Yes, there can be unusual cases with this thing. We should act accordingly. But the average 17-year-old that has no symptoms is going to have no symptoms if she's reinfected.
I have a question for you, Dr. Drew.
Yeah.
I had a girlfriend who's 48, and she got it. Her husband got it. And then she told me she's immune now. Like, she can't get it again. Is that true?
How long ago did she get it?
She got it over Christmas.
Yeah, she's immune if almost certainly for 6 months. But beyond that, we don't know. And I can tell you, remember Kevin and Bean?
Yep.
Kevin got a second COVID infection after 6 months. Bad. It was like spring. It was like almost a year. So it was almost a year. Then he got it again. And he went to the hospital really sick, said, "I can't have COVID because I've already had it." They tested him anyway. God. He had COVID. And so happen. It does happen. You should monitor things accordingly. Thanks, Sean. Good luck with that.
Sean.
I have a call now from, let's take a break before I go to Leopold, who is someone that's on our locals format and a frequent participant on the chat stream, got COVID, and he has multiple risk factors and was hospitalized, and he's going to give us an update on his COVID condition after this quick break.
Okay.
Well, I too have struggled with GI issues over the years. I have something called Lynch syndrome, so gut health is extremely important to me. And while gut health awareness has increased, it's led to a wellness trend that's inspired a host of questionable marketing and some false claims. Now, you've seen the word probiotic attached to all kinds of supplements, drinks, even more. They may claim to deliver the healthy microorganisms our gut needs for proper function, but all too often the promises are in fact too good to be true. Thankfully, I became aware of a company called Seed and their flagship product, the Daily Symbiotic. Seed's Daily Symbiotic offers 24 clinically researched strains of microorganisms in a single dose. These strains support gut health and can improve regularity and relieve bloating, sometimes within as little as 24 to 48 hours. To me, what really sets Seed's Daily Symbiotic apart is the delivery system. While some products may offer the right strains, they're fragile, they rarely survive the trip through the gut, doesn't get where it needs to go, but Seed uses a capsule-in-capsule design that helps ensure the probiotic reaches your colon, which is where they often are needed. I've been taking Seed's Daily Symbiotic, and I really encourage you to check out their story and the science behind what they do. To try it for yourself, just go to seed.com/Dr. Drew. Use code Dr. Drew 20 for 15% off your first month of Daily Symbiotic. That is SEED.com/Dr. Drew. Use code Dr. Drew 20. As we're gradually moving back to opening schools and businesses and, of course, our in-person interactions, I want to remind you, this is all time with cold and flu season getting going. Staying hydrated is key to helping your body deal with the added stress and with the upcoming flu season. My regular fans have heard me talk about a product called Hydrolyte for a long time now. It's an amazing rapid rehydration drink. It's a mix that, well, we're obsessed with here. I'm excited to announce they've just released Hydrolyte Plus Immunity just in time for cold and flu season. Hydrolyte Plus Immunity starts with their fast-absorbing electrolytes and adds a host of immune-boosting ingredients. Each single-serve, easy-pour drink mix contains 1,000 milligrams of vitamin C and 300 milligrams of elderberry extract, creates what is hopefully immune-boosting formula that's high in antioxidants and zinc. Combining this with Hydrolite's 7 key electrolytes, it's a fantastic way to stay proactive and properly hydrated. Hydrolite Plus Immunity comes in convenient, easy-to-pour powder sticks that rapidly dissolve in water and make a great-tasting drink that has 75% less sugar than your typical sports drink. It uses all natural flavors, and it is gluten-free, dairy-free, caffeine-free, non-GMO, and it is vegan. And you can find Hydrolite Plus by visiting hydrolite.com/Dr. Drew. Again, that's hydrolyte.com/drdrw. And be sure to use our code DrDrew25 at checkout for a special discount. The Ask Jillian podcast, and is your Twitter handle up there? Yes, it is. It I can't. Ask Jillian, and thank you to Hydrolite and to, of course, Blue Mics and to our seed people and Halidine. Remember, there's certain things that this illness has, or the presence of this pandemic, has changed my behavior. And one is I use this Povidone product before I fly. It's a nasal swab and a spray for your mouth that kicks the virus out before it has a chance to get into your body. And then, of course, I'm a big believer in cleaning surfaces with UVC. We actually bought a UVC light for our friend Anthony Brown, and he now decontaminates his entire hospital with our UVC instruments.
Oh my gosh!
Yeah, it's
These are new.
This is iWand, and this is an incredible product. Just carry it with me everywhere, and then of course Halidine.com.
Dr. Drew, I have a question. I know we have a caller, but before we do that, when I was going through chemo, you gave me those vitamin C. I would put them in my drinks, and they were amazing.
Hydrolite.
And then
that was Hydrolite.
Hydrolite. Yeah. I love.
I know.
And helped me restore my body.
There was one night when I was real bad with COVID. I took 7 sticks in about an hour, and I felt better afterwards. It's like an IV hydration type
setup. Absolutely.
Yeah.
It is.
Thank you for saying that. I know we swear by that stuff.
It's true, because I would get my chemo, and then I would have somebody come with an IV on Saturday because I had that thing in my arm that would release the whatever, and she would stick me with the IV. I would drink about 3 or 4 of those a day, every day, leading up to chemo, and I just handled chemo like you saw me. I was bald. Yep. I had no lashes or bronze, but I flew through it. I was on the radio every day. I had great energy. And I honestly believe it was part of that. And then the other commercial you did reminded me, I've got to get a colonoscopy. Oh, my God.
So I did the colonoscopy about 6 weeks ago. I mean, I was thinking I just did it, but it was before I got sick. And I have to get them every year. Yeah.
Well, doesn't everybody over 50 have to get them every year?
No, it's 7. Oh. It's depending on your risk factors. It's 3 to 5 if they find polyps. It's 7 to 10 if you're the average risk. But I have something called Lynch syndrome, so I have to, I have to monitor more carefully. My sons have it too, and they started having their scans, their colonoscopies at 25, didn't they, or 26?
Wow.
Yeah, crazy. Oh. Yeah, crazy.
Yeah.
Jeez. All right. This is Leopold. Hey, Leopold, how you doing, buddy?
Hey, Dr. Drew, thank you for having me on today.
Of course.
And I wanted to thank you, and especially all the folks on our website, that showed the support during this tough time, but thank you again.
You made it through. It was a little kind of wonky there when you were hospitalized. So Leopold got the remdesivir anything else they give you? They gave you some steroids too, right?
They gave me steroids, and then, of course, a lot of oxygen, and unfortunately, I'm still on oxygen at 2 liters a minute, and trying to get that oxygen up, past, 92, and that seems to be kind of a threshold for me. For whatever reason, I can't seem to get beyond it, so I'm on that oxygen condenser all day long. So,
hey, let me share with you again. I really believe we should be improvising with this illness to the extent that we have available medication that has been time honored and safe. Because I got diverticulitis complicating. Speaking of colonoscopy, I got diverticulitis complicating my course, probably caused by the Decadron or predisposed to the Decadron. But one of the medicines they gave me for the diverticulitis was a antibiotic for anaerobic infections. And I noticed that there was a lot of reports, increasing reports of lung abscesses late with COVID. And the treatment for lung abscesses is this medication. And I noticed when I took it, it pushed my lungs forward. I was having more trouble with the breathing, and I took, it's called Flagyl or metronidazole. And it seemed to really help my lungs. So you might want to bring that up with your doctor. There's sort of no harm, no foul in that, it seems to me.
Oh, okay. It's called metronidazole?
Flagyl, right? Just Flagyl. Just, it's Flagyl, F-L-A-G-Y-L. And they could add another antibiotic to it to like and you push them to say, hey, let's try some antibiotics for my lungs. They're not clearing. Maybe some of this is a delayed infectious effect. And my experience was sort of striking. The Flagyl seemed to help. It didn't help with the fatigue much and all that stuff, but it helped with the congestion.
Yeah.
I have a question for Leopold.
Oh, and how are you doing yourself with the... with the fatigue, by the way?
It sucks.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It sucks. But Julie has a question.
I was just curious, yeah. Leopold, were you, you were hospitalized. Did they have to intubate you?
No.
Okay. Oh, no. Thank goodness.
No, thankfully.
He's what they call a desaturated. He's severe COVID in the sense that he's desaturated. His O2 is dropping. He's hospitalized, but he wasn't ICU material. He held in.
Oh, thank God.
Yeah.
Good. Yeah.
Yeah. Good times, man.
Hey, I'm sorry, my brain fog is acting up. Like, can you spell that again for me?
I understand. It's F-L-A-G-Y-L. F-A-L-G-Y-L. Flagyl.
G-Y-L. Yeah. Okay. In fact, I have an appointment with my doctor tomorrow. So.
Good. It's just, push him for antibiotics and then go, hey, I hear they're having lung abscesses, it's complicating this thing. Maybe some antibiotics, maybe some Flagyl. It's a little bit of a slop shot, but it seemed to help me. So just saying, and yeah, the fatigue is insane.
And there's really no downside, right?
Flagyl is very
Does it still affect you?
What?
Yeah.
Does what still affect me?
I was gonna say, how's your fatigue?
It's nasty. I'm not myself. I am pretty lucky cognitively, but I do get a little dazed and out of it and sort of I concentrate, I can make my brain work, but I'm a little off balance. I get ringing in my ears. I get fullness in my head. It's really just a good time. It's really a good time.
My fiance thinks that extra, walking and stuff to make my lungs more expanded. But man, this thing is kicking my butt trying to just walk up and down.
That's
around the neighborhood.
That's the part I'm trying to navigate. I'm not convinced. I do think that walking is a good thing. We know it's good to expand your lungs. We know you need to kind of not get debilitated by this thing. So you do need to walk around. But how much to push ourselves is not all that clear to me. When I pushed myself, I really got to lie down for a while afterwards. I really feel it, and it doesn't seem to push me forward particularly. So I don't know. So there you go.
Yeah, and that was my dilemma. I don't want to seem real wimpy, but the fact is, it seems to kick my butt. When I try to do the exercise or whatever.
I still think you should do it, but I would not expect it to move things forward necessarily. Yeah. And don't push too hard. Yeah. And I had another strange reaction too, Jillian, listen to this. So, and it didn't work last night, by the way, Susan, it didn't work. Two nights in a row, I went out to dinner. My first outing was going out to dinner three nights ago. It was like Saturday or something, four nights ago.
Okay.
And I halfway through, I was like, oh, I'm not going to make it. And I had a glass of wine. Wait a minute. I got a glass of wine, and I felt great all of a sudden. It was very strange. Yeah. I was like, and so I tried it again the next night, and it helped again. It was very strange. So
calling me and telling me that the wine was working.
Yeah, I was like, wow, this is very, this normally I get more tired, but it kind of cleared me up and gave me energy. That's and then I tried it again last night and it did not work.
Maybe
did
you
not
drank
work.
Too much.
I think that may be.
You were pouring heavy last night.
Yeah, I was looking for that
red or white wine.
Well, I've tried both, and the red seemed a little better at first. The white worked, and then the red last night did not work.
I think you drank a little more.
I think you got to limit it to like one glass or one and a half glass.
Move on over to whiskey now.
I can.
Well, hey, you convinced me. You convinced me, Dr. Drew.
Well, I mean, listen, cough syrups and things like that are very high in alcohol. People that are sick take a little alcohol all the time without getting harmed. Obviously, if you have liver disease, you want to watch out. But all right, Leopold, it's just good to hear your voice. I know everyone's pulling for you. We've had lots of updates on you. And, you know, here's the deal with two more things for you. A, people get better. Okay. They get better. It's just a matter of how long, right? People get better. Just how long, number one. Number two, I did a show on Friday you may want to look at. It's on the website, I assume, right, with Steve Kirsch?
Yeah.
Yes.
And he was very persuasive. Okay. Yeah, he was very persuasive about fluvoxamine. And I'm thinking if I'm still bad at the end of the week, I'm probably going to – not bad. If I'm not a lot better at the end of the week, I'll probably try it too. Fluvoxamine looks very good for long haulers. Something to think about.
Yeah,
okay?
He was very persuasive.
Okay. All right, Leopold, talk soon.
Very good. He still wants you to do it, though, Drew. He's mad you haven't.
You bet. He what? I know he wants me to do it, but I'm not prepared.
You're not prepared.
It will shut me down in a million other ways, too, honey, that you may not like.
So. I know. The first thing I asked him was, is it going to help with your libido? Or hurt your libido? And he goes, it might. And I go, well.
She's not so interested. Suddenly she stopped talking about it.
No, she stopped talking to you about it. She's talking to me about it.
Yeah, right. right. Thank you. This is great. I love being ganged up on.
I love the approach that, hey, you have to also be your own doctor in a sense, because this is uncharted, you know, and so you'll say, maybe, you know, if your lungs were pushed forward and it gave you some relief, maybe.
That's
that's
why I'm glad I got it and can help with some of these ideas. But doctors are being very conservative, really, when they should be being very aggressive. I don't understand why they're so conservative. These are medicines that we've used forever. They're harmless and might help in the COVID setting. Why not deploy them there? It's very weird. Yep. And it's, you know, it's even a weirder thing. Every surgeon I talk to is on it, gets right on it, and starts improvising. Every internist I talk to, it's not yet been orthodoxy. It's not enough, not been reproduced data, blah, 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 blah. I'm like, yeah, I know. We're getting there. The science is getting there. In the meantime, you have sick people on your hands. Help them. So anyway,
that's interesting.
Yeah, it is very interesting. All right. Speaking of a long hauler symptoms, this is Jeremy. Hi, Jeremy.
Hi, Dr. Drew. How are you?
I'm good, buddy. What's happening? You're in the long hauler basket with the rest of us?
I'm kind of like on that transition phase. You know, I'm kind of at the 2 month mark where I still have a lot of fatigue, brain fog. You know, like you were 2 hours of doing something.
2 months? If I have it, I'm going to jump off the building if it's 2 months. If I'm still having it. Has it improved at all since, say, 1 month? Yeah. Has it gotten better?
So I kind of like in you where I don't notice improvements day to day, but if I look back last month, am I better?
Yeah, that's what I figured.
But it's been very, very slow.
Very slow, yeah.
Like I feel like the brain fog kind of cleared a little bit, but some other issues that I'm having, which I don't know if other people are, is I'm having a lot of like nerve and leg pain. Like my legs are, you know, pretty much hurt all the time. Like I can't run anymore, just go for small walks and it hurts.
Have you checked your
oxygen before?
Yeah. Oh, yes. Various versions of that. I'll tell you my own version of it in a second. God. But have you checked your oxygen saturation to make sure you're not desaturating?
Yeah, I have an O2 sat. I'm always like right around 98%. Right. I don't feel like it's in my lungs, but I feel like I feel short of breath, but it's not like I can't breathe.
Right.
So it's hard to describe.
Yeah, you know? I have the same.
I'm too sad. I feel weak.
I get it. I got all that. I have a thing where my legs get numb and tingly. Woke up in the middle of the night with squeezing ankle pain, like a knife going into my ankle, and my muscles in my legs suddenly get sore for no reason. Like I'll be walking down the stairs going, my legs are sore. How weird is that? So yeah, I know what you're talking about. I don't know what it is.
I don't know if I jump in for you, but it moves around. Like one day it's my calf, the next day it's my hip, the next day it's my knee. Like it's
just, except
it's
for that,
like it's that one muscle. It's just constantly
mine was around. Unilateral ankle. Otherwise, it's been fairly symmetrical and consistent. It's been all the entire leg, except for that one ankle thing last night, which was weird. It woke me up from sleep, and I thought, oh, good, COVID is doing something else to me. How fantastic. What's that, Jillian?
You know, I have to a lot of your symptoms, when I was going through chemo, my legs, I would punch my legs. They ached so badly. I would be watching a movie, and my legs would just, and I couldn't sleep, and I would punch my legs just to get, like, just, and so I went on Twitter, true story, I went on Twitter at like 3 a.m. and I was so fucking over it. And I said, does anyone else have this issue with chemo? I got bombarded. First of all, my doctor gave me painkillers. They did nothing. My legs were still throbbing. Like I thought it was bone pain, but it was nerve. So then I went on the gabapentin and it stopped. And I was like, holy shit, like, is that a nerve thing, Drew?
Yes, gabapentin is a neuropathy medicine, amongst other things. But yes, it's very good for that. So that's probably what it is.
Earlier, Decadrone. I was on Decadrone. So I'm feeling like some of the symptoms are very similar to going through chemo.
Which kind of makes sense, right? It's like there's this giant inflammatory poison going on. You know, it sort of makes sense.
Oh, my God.
And Jeremy, the other thing I've done, believe it or not, is I have used Theragun. You know, the Theragun pulsating massager?
Like the massage.
Massager. I've been using that on my legs like crazy, and it's been, it doesn't sustain, but it feels, I get relief from it. So that, and you can get, they have a little small one, little triangle one that's not very expensive. I've been using that one. It's probably, you know, probably my favorite.
Really?
Yeah.
Another interesting thing that's kind of going on with me is I'm an identical twin brother.
Oof.
And both of us got COVID at the same time. And we're both, like, I mean, our symptomology was exact. Like, we both are long haulers, pretty much. We're both, he has leg pain, he has pain, he's got brain fog.
So, Jeremy.
Whereas for me, my question for you is the brain,
This is a perfect, we have monozygotic twins with dual infecting agents, both with chronic COVID. One of you taking fluvoxamine would be very interesting. One takes fluvoxamine, one doesn't.
Get Steve Kirsch on the phone.
You want to get Steve Kirsch in here? Yeah. So I'm ready for the fluvoxamine, and I'm not 2 months in. I'm a month in. At 5 weeks, I'm going to take some fluvoxamine if I'm still
like this. Considering it.
Yeah, talk to your doctor about that. And again, watch that Friday show I did with Steve Kirsch. He was very, very, a lot of good data. Okay. So, and I sent it all to Dr. Jillian.
I'm curious because he has a twin brother. You guys have triplets, but only one of you. Is it different for, you know what I mean? Like,
we have fraternal. Everybody's dizygotic. They're different.
Okay. Got it.
Jeremy is monozygotic, meaning he's genetically identical to his twin.
Wow.
Listen. For those of you, you know, if Joe, you're on the line or anybody else, I saw Tom's in there. Maybe Dr. Yogendra, they're doing studies on long haulers, and you two would be a bonanza monozygotic twins.
We met you right before your trip to Cabo. We actually met and took a picture with you. We're the twin firefighters.
Oh, my God, in the airport, right?
Yeah.
After that? It must have been.
I did. I went back to work, and then shortly after work, we were just getting like bombarded with COVID cases, and sure enough, I ended up getting it.
That is
incredible. Maybe you gave it to
Dr. Drew. No, that was a month before.
No, that was way before I got it. Way before.
You didn't get it in Cabo.
Oh, yeah, no, it was.
I would have loved to.
I didn't get it until I got way back, like a week or two.
So here's what I want to do, Jeremy. I'm going to put you on hold. Let's get Jeremy's email, too.
Okay.
And talk. In the meantime, you talk to your doctor about fluvoxamine or Luvox, okay? Jeremy?
Yeah,
talk to him about that.
And do you mind if I ask you just one real quick question?
Yeah.
I ask you so the other issue that my brother is kind of different than me. He's having a lot of like the brain fog, this cloud that comes over his head.
Yeah.
Like, what is causing that? And like, is there something we could do? Like, should we exercise our mind or do like mental things?
The answer is we don't know. We don't even know what's happening. We know that there's microangiopathic changes in the nasal bulbs, meaning blood vessels are getting.
Steve Kirsch is here.
Oh, well.
That was cool.
Well, I'm not really ready for that.
You can bring them both on at the same time.
Okay, hold on a second.
Awesome.
We know there are these microangiopathic changes, and there's probably some blood vessel changes. There's definitely inflammation. There may be direct neuronal infection, and my sense is when my lungs are active, I get more brain fog. So to answer your question specifically, I've been reading books on chess, like chess problem solving, and it has helped me. It has helped me clear the fog a little bit.
Really good.
Yeah. Wow. And I've been doing some modest sort of weightlifting exercise, that kind of thing. It wears me out. I can't do that much, but it does seem to help with the fog and sleep. Sleep seems to be very helpful. And then we're going to talk to a guy right now. I'm going to put you on hold.
No, you can put them both on this.
I'm going to put you on hold, Jeremy, and I want you to listen to Steve Kirsch because he is deep. Where is he? There he is. He is deep in the research of all this, and he and I'll go over it while you're on hold. But also, I want you to leave your email with my screener, okay? Jeremy?
Okay, I will.
All right, and then I'm going to hook you up with Dr. Yogendra. So we'll bring Steve back around here, Steve Kirsch. Listen on Friday, see all the data he has to present if you want to hear more about what Steve has to tell us. Welcome back, Steve.
Hi, Dr. Drew.
Hey there.
Good to be back.
You're on with Jillian Barberie as well, who's on with me. And we just had a pair of monozygotic twins with 2-month chronic COVID, and I thought, oh my God, put one of you on fluvoxamine and one of you not, you'll have the perfect experimental paradigm.
Sure. Or you can put them on and then take them off and put them on and take them off and
cross them over.
Look at the correlation.
Or how about we give one of them a sugar pill and one of them, here's the ideal way to do it. Oh, one of them a sugar pill, one of them fluvoxamine, and then cross them over and then cross them back and see who has clinical response.
Yeah, well, you know, the one thing that we didn't talk about is that the way you can tell if you're on fluvoxamine is that if you take any caffeine at all while you're on fluvoxamine, it will magnify the effect of the caffeine. It will be like taking 6 times as much caffeine, and it will last for over 24 hours.
That sounds wonderful.
Oh my
sounds,
God.
That sounds
that's
wonderful.
Right. You want to tell. That's the way to
tell. Sounds fantastic.
No, it's not. You're not going to sleep.
Yeah.
You're not going to sleep on that.
Interesting.
That's horrible.
So yeah. I have improved since we talked, and particularly the brain fog and that kind of stuff has not been bothering me too much. But the fatigue still bugs me, and I did discuss it with my doctor, and we are in the process of figuring out if and when. But if I'm still like this at the end of the week, then I will probably be starting fluvoxamine.
No. You know, I keep telling you, start it now. You have nothing. You have everything to gain right now. You're a terrible patient.
No, I'm working with my doctor. I know.
I'm worried about his libido.
Yeah, I'm worried about everything else. The fact just that I mean, how much better than good can I be? You know what I mean? I'm pretty good. And I don't want to and I'm prone to being aggressive with this thing. I'm very sympathetic to, you know, people using this. I've recommended on a number of people now to use fluvoxamine, and we'll see how it goes. But, I'm on the verge myself. I know.
Listen, you're talking, man.
Your words were ringing in my head from Friday. It was like, stop the inflammation. The sooner you stop the inflammation, the better. Stop now. So, you know, go ahead.
This is exactly what happens. This is what happens to other doctors as well. Like, there's this resistance to doing anything new that they haven't done before. And you know, you're just showing people why. Because people are wondering, like, if this drug is so good, then how come everybody's not using it? And you're like, you're showing people exactly why they're not. The resistance that you're putting up. There's no reason that you can't. Just try it with 50 milligrams once a day.
All right.
I guarantee you will see an amazing difference. Just 50 milligrams once a day. Will you do that?
I will call my doctor first thing. Or I'll send him an email when I finish up here. And I will suggest we do that.
You better, because I'm wondering if doctors make horrible patients.
Doctors make horrible patients. Yeah, we do. Yes, I know. But I'm trying to be a good one. So, Steve, I just wanted to report to you that the monozygotic twins, and I'm going to try to get going with this too. Do you have somebody specifically that we can refer people to get people on fluvoxamine if they're interested?
Yes. I have several doctors that I can refer you to, and also City Health Urgent Care will be starting up a practice so that anybody can call them up and get a fluvoxamine prescription from anywhere in the country. And that should be up within a few days.
So and this is all, I can, all of it is, everybody's telehealth, right? Both the City Health and the individual physicians. Yeah.
City Health Urgent Care is telehealth, but you can also go into one of their clinics as well.
And do they have a website? Just look up City Health, Google City Health.
Cityhealthuc.com.
Okay, Jeremy, who's on hold listening to this. Jeremy, cityhealthuc.com. And, you know, it'd be interesting if you started and stopped. And, well, it's not going to be blinded because no one's going to be administering this to you. But it'll be interesting to see if you respond and your monozygotic twin does not. Be very interesting. All right, Steve, thanks for calling in. I appreciate it. Go ahead.
Yeah, and we don't know, actually, because nobody has tried this for long-haul COVID yet. You know, it's surprising, but it's as far as I know, no one has tried it yet. I've talked to one long-hauler, and I suggested it to her, and I don't know if she started yet.
All right. I get it, and I've been running it all up the flagpole. Believe me, I've sent around your data and everything else to people that who are working with the long haulers, and I've not gotten a formal read yet from those guys. I think that's probably what delayed me a little bit. You know, I was waiting for them to tell me, you know, by all means, try this. We're signing off on it. But, Steve, thanks, buddy.
Yeah,
what's that?
Right.
On your way?
I was just going to say that I was on that. I was on a Zoom call earlier today with one of the top infectious disease doctors in America. And, you know, this is like one of the key opinion leaders. And so we talked about fluvoxamine, and I said, look, the evidence doesn't get any better than this. I mean, this is like, if you could change one thing, like, well, what would you change? He said, well, I'd like more evidence. Yeah. But if the evidence is there, like, it's perfect. I mean, you can't do any better than this. And he had no objections.
There's two things. You need to open that RCT study. As soon as that's open, I think that'll be a big deal. And the strength of having one observer in your initial study in the racehorse group, the racetrack group, is the researchers will see as a weakness because there's potential bias with one observer. Those are the two things I would change.
Yeah.
That's it. But
I mean, you know, of course. Yeah. Right. You can always pick on something.
Yes.
But, you know, this is, let's say it's almost as good as you can get.
Yes. It sure looks it.
Yeah. I mean, his treatment group was actually, he got the short end of the stick. And so even though it's pseudo-randomized, it's actually better data because he got 12.5 hospitalization rate in the in the no treatment group, and he got 0% in the treatment group, and he got the short end of the stick. So, I mean, it's very impressive. Anyway,
all right, my friend. Talk soon.
Thank you.
Take care. That is Steve Kirsch. His email is stevekirsch.com. Is that Steve Kirsch? Steve Kirsch is the Twitter handle. Jillian, any questions about that?
Long haulers. Until this moment, I've never.
So Jeremy and I are long haulers. Long haulers are technically 3 weeks or longer, and this typical symptoms is everything you've heard us talk about: fog, fatigue, cough.
Your legs are down.
Not really. It's just. It might. Yeah. No. It should help everything if it works. We don't hear you.
Yeah.
On the mic.
I know. Go ahead.
No, it won't hit with the body aches and not being able to.
Yeah,
stamina.
It should help all that. Should help all that.
It helps with OCD too.
Yeah, I know.
That would be great because I definitely have that. But I wanted to ask you a question. You know, when you say you have brain fog, there's something when you get chemo, they call it chemo brain. And I think it's the same sort of thing. Is it like where you walk into a room and you're like, why am I in here?
It's more of what I imagine would happen from a head injury. Like I'm sort of, oh, I'm, and wow. Susan described it. She goes, you know, you're dazed some of the time. And I thought, oh yeah, that's it. You sort of seem like you're okay. And it's
zoned out.
It's just not all there and not aware that you're not all there. You know what I mean? When I'm good, I'm good. But if I exert myself a lot, I would get ringing in my ears. I'll get fullness in my head. I'll get tightness in my chest. And that's all long hauler stuff. So
it's like an aerobics class.
Okay. Oh, yuck.
You know, when you start getting tired and you can't, you get all those symptoms.
Yeah.
It's just like that.
I still have, I don't know how long I can keep saying I have chemo brain, but I it's definitely dulled me a little bit in a very strange way. But it's funny, I can hear it in your voice a little bit. And so after today, will you say, when you go lie down, do you nap? Do you sleep early? Or are you a bad, like Susan was saying, you're not really a good napper, but
no.
Do you just lie down and watch a movie? Like, how do you get your
Lately, I've been able to read a little bit, so I'll probably try to read. But usually, what I do is sit and stare at TikTok, like, and I have no idea that, and I have no idea that time is passing. It's weird.
It is great.
It's a weird
communist plot. This COVID-19.
I get into like a trance.
All watch TikTok.
I get into like a weird TikTok. Trance with it.
Love it. I've gotten great recipes there. And then I don't know if you saw, and I'm curious because you're a doctor. Last night I saw something really disturbing. It was Kellyanne Conway's daughter. And she had posted some stuff, her mom screaming and saying, you know, fuck you, you fucking 15-year-old. And she said, smacking her. And it was horrible. And like, she's like, I'm 15. And she's like, I don't give a fuck. You're telling everybody I'm a fucking bitch. And da 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 da. And then she hits her. And then she throws... she throws the laundry at her and I clean your fucking sheets. I mean, the F-bombs or something, but everyone's like, my God, call child services. And I didn't want to retweet it because I didn't want to put it out there, but I'm really feeling for her. I know that, you know, when I was a teenage daughter, I was not easy. There's no way. I mean, I used to tell my mom, well, you're not my real mom because I was adopted. Like, that's pretty friggin' mean, right? And so...
it's a classic though, Jillian. It's a classic.
I know. So I was just curious if, like, you know, putting it out there and, you know, is that a good thing or is it a bad thing? Because, you know, it's on TikTok and that's what reminded me of it. You know, exactly. I felt so bad for her.
No, it's bad. This is social media at its worst. I know that daughter has a lot of psychiatric stuff going on and she needs proper care. And that's that.
My mother would have been a star on TikTok for being a bitch.
Oh, really?
My son's on TikTok all the time. My mom was pretty brutal too, Susan. Oh, she could be tough. And my kids are like, Nana, because she's so mellow now, although she does have dementia. So she's now on stage, I think, 5. Mm. Yeah, it's pretty bad. And
payback.
I swear it is.
My mom had that too.
Yeah, it's bad.
She said, I'm going to grow old and be that mean old lady in the corner of the room that it pisses everybody off because you guys all just took the life out of me and then she forgot. I was young and I was like, that's such a mean thing to say. Like, God, who says stuff like that? And then she hit 50 and I'm like, boop.
Hi, Victor. What's going on, Victor?
Victor.
Hey, Dr. Drew.
Hey, buddy.
Jillian B.
Hey.
It's good to be on with you all. So,
good to talk to you.
I was raised out of the country and was given a BCG vaccine.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering how effective that is with helping with COVID and the symptoms and recovery and whatnot.
There was some talk about it early, but it does not seem to do much. So
what's BCG?
Bacillus, I forget the name of it. You know, it's a tuberculosis vaccine, sort of. That's what they think they're doing. And a lot of other countries use it, and it's just to diminish risk of certain things. And there was some stuff early that kind of looked like, oh, maybe it's going to have some effect, but I never saw any more conversation about it after the beginning. So I don't think, as this thing has sort of burgeoned along, it's not like countries that give BCG have been, for whatever reason, having less severe COVID, that kind of thing. Thanks, Victor. And this is Barbara.
Hi, Barbara.
Hang on. Let's see if I can get it up here. Barbara.
Whoa. Okay. Isolate that. Yeah. Hi, Barbara.
It's like, what'd you call it? Radio drop.
Hey, how are you?
Hi, Barbara.
sorry about that. I was falling asleep. I ended up, I thought I had COVID. My tests keep coming back negative. Mm-hmm. I had like 3 or 4 tests. I ended up in the ER, like, it wasn't even an hour because they didn't want a lot of people back in the, they were flooded with COVID patients.
Yeah.
And they're a trauma center now. So they looked in my ear. Mm-hmm. And then I have I can't hear really, really well. So if I'm talking too loud, sorry about that. I have a really bad like ear infection in my left ear, and it's like swollen shut. They couldn't see my eardrum.
Okay, so that's an external. That's an external otitis. That's nasty. Those can get very bad, and that needs to be treated. And listen, it's not as though COVID is the only illness that exists in America. You know, the other illnesses keep happening, right?
Right.
In your case,
right. It's affecting all of my sinuses.
Oh yeah, I know. You can hear it. And it sounds. You know, the fact that it closed the canal, the external auditory canal. That can be fungus or bacteria. So it's no fooling. You got to really pay attention to this. You got to get thorough treatment. You probably should see an ENT doctor.
Right, because it's starting to. Because they told me that they asked me if it's draining at all. Mm-hmm. And it started to after I went to the ER.
Mm-hmm.
Gross. It has a smell to it.
Mm, lovely.
Because there's pus back there. They told me there's strep throat back there.
Yeah, you listen. Oh, listen.
How does that happen?
Here's that it. Strep
can't
happens.
They drain
bacteria
it
is. That's why. It's why I still use UVC light and things like that. All the other illnesses we have had that are waiting to capture, humans. They're still alive and well, and they are still quite active. In this case, you have an external otitis. You have sinusitis. Probably bacterial. You need ear drops. You need oral antibiotics. You need a bunch of things. And somebody's got to take a look at this because sometimes even on top of the bacteria, you can get a fungus. So somebody needs to follow up on this. That's the important thing.
Can they drain it for her, Dr. Drew?
It's the external canal. So it's,
antibiotics.
And it sounds like the middle ear may have drained on its own anyway, but the external canal can create a bunch of fluids, nasty stuff as well. So, Wait. First, Jillian. Hang on, Dave. Jillian, go ahead.
Wait. Okay. You know how you watch TikTok? I watch Dr. Pimple Popper, but mostly I'll put in pus with incisions and surgeries, and I'll watch that for hours. It's fantastic.
Congratulations. Congratulations.
Yes.
I love it. I have seen and done enough of that in my career that I have no such drive, no such desire to watch those things.
Love it.
Isn't that funny? That's very funny. Okay, yeah. let's get Dave back up here.
Hi, Dave.
Yes. Hi, Dr. Drew.
Hey, buddy.
Jillian. Just for Jillian, my mother was a cancer survivor of 20 years, and she's passed by now, but it wasn't due to cancer, and she did great, so I'm sure you will,
bless
too.
Her. God bless her. Did she have breast cancer, if you don't mind me asking?
I don't know. She was diagnosed in the mid-80s, just after Nancy Reagan, I believe.
Okay.
It was interesting, the things that she went through with her doctor, and she probably got another doctor that was wanted to be not quite as aggressive, and it worked out well for her. So,
good.
You know, hang in there.
Yes. Thank you.
But Dr. Drew,
I love hearing stories like that.
You're absolutely. Doctor, I wanted to ask you, for just a regular person out in the middle of America, let's assume for a moment that either you have COVID or you see a doctor about COVID and you're not happy with maybe that they're not, you feel they're not being aggressive enough.
Yeah, yeah.
How would you choose another doctor? Interview? That seems kind of odd for
it is rough, especially
anyway.
Yeah, especially rough now when you really don't want to go into doctor's offices and expose everybody. Mm-hmm. Once you have COVID, you have to be doing this all through telemedicine, and everybody's busy. They may not have time for that. They may not want it. that you just heard, when Steve Kirsch called in, there's a group called cityhealthuc.com, cityhealthuc, that apparently is taking people over telehealth. We keep hearing that speakwithanmd.com is also very good, we are hearing. Heal is an organization I've worked with. They've got good quality physicians. Heal, it's getheal.com, H-E-A-L. And these are all organizations that do telehealth, and they do it pretty well. So you can try those. As always, what people complain about is that doctors don't sit and think and listen. And if you get somebody in telehealth that's willing to sit there and think about things and seems to care a bit about what's going on with you, those seem to be organizations. Although I heard some, and we got some feedback on Speak with an MD that wasn't so great.
Yeah,
there was some concern about that. Heal has always been very good. It's hard. It is hard.
They're great. I've used them. Yeah,
It's hard. Primary care medicine is a terrible job now, and so it's not attracting people who are necessarily that committed to it.
That national doctor thing that Kelly Victory and, the national.
Yeah, no, that's not. Mm-mm.
No?
No, I wouldn't do that. But part of that was speakwithanmd.com, so that's fine.
Right.
It's hard. It is hard.
So just a quick follow-up. Is this, for example, for myself, I'm 60 years old.
Yeah.
I haven't had COVID yet, at least to my knowledge. Is this maybe a conversation I should have with my doctor at this point? Say, how do you feel about treating this aggressively?
Yeah, how aggressive? Kind of what's your philosophy? 100%. I think that's a very reasonable thing. Or if he has a assistant or anything, by all means, have those conversations. And even go to so far as maybe you don't want to keep medicines on hand because we want that for people that really need it. But yeah, I think that's absolutely. I would agree.
I think Caleb posted the list on drdrew.com. Yeah. What's the link, Caleb?
It's drdrew.com/COVID. Has the whole list.
Perfect.
Did you put the fluoxetine on there?
Right.
I don't believe so.
Yeah.
I think we added it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Part of my concern is I travel a lot in my job. And if I'm stuck in a hotel and somewhere that I don't know, it would be nice to have something on hand.
Yes, I totally agree. And I'm telling you something, man. Even though I got sick, I should have used Halidon more religiously than I did. But I've spoken to the researchers, the chemist and physician that made this stuff, and I was persuaded by what he had to offer. So it's another thing to kind of, again, just sort of reduce your risks, right? Try to decrease the probability of this stuff happening. Mask and distance and all that stuff.
All right.
But planes, but just travel generally is, of course, a potential environment for transmission. Are you traveling much? Mm-hmm. Jillian, are you traveling much?
Oh, God, no. I haven't left this house in a year, Dr. Drew. But you know what? All of my friends, and I have 8 friends that have COVID right now, and they all traveled over the holidays. I was frightened because of my underlying conditions. I just said it's not worth it. But you know what's weird? My son is homeschooling, but my daughter's school went back, and I was terrified. Like, I make her shower. She doesn't even come in the house. I make her go out. Side and shower because I'm terrified. And when I take her to school in the morning, I wear a mask. She wears a mask. It's like, what are the school opening and maybe somebody getting, I don't know, everyone's like, oh, it's just a bad cold. All my friends that have had it.
It's a bad cold for your daughter, but for if she brings it home to
me,
you, yeah, that's
I
kind
know.
Of a different thing.
I also have a friend, he's 49. I think I told you about him perhaps once, but he got COVID and he was intubated and they did not think he was going to make it. He was one of the first. He's the one that Jennifer Aniston talked about, that she had a friend. And he's been a great friend for many years, and he's completely, healthy, works out, 49, doesn't smoke, he drinks wine at dinners here and there, but he got it and he got hit hard. And he went and he was at UCLA for almost 40 days.
Ugh.
He didn't eat, drink. He was intubated for 30 days,
is he
or 30
okay now?
Something days. He lost 50 pounds. He is fine. But let me tell you, it was when he got off, he videoed us and I didn't recognize him. I was like, wait, who's, And he was, he said, thank you. You know, his voice was still fucked up because of the intubation.
Yeah.
We were terrified. He was 49, and I was thinking, holy shit, like, this is really scary. But then my other friends get, they're like, oh, it's a really bad cold. So I don't know. You just don't know, right?
I think so much is being made of the mortality of this thing. Not enough is made of the morbidity, the fact that it injures people and that it makes people really sick and miserable in ways that are really intense, even though they survive and the data's on your side.
So,
but it's like 20%. They're saying 60% long haulers now. And so it's a real deal. It's something, and that part's, of course, the press is not talking about that part. All they can talk about is the deaths, which are unlikely.
Yeah.
But happen. Yes. They're just unlikely. Listen.
What happened?
Joe Giannata is a friend of ours, and he wants to talk about some different companies for telehealth, as long as we brought that up. And Joe, congratulations on your career choices.
Well, thank you. And I've been posting everything on Locals. Hi, Jillian.
Hi, Joe.
Great that you're on. And this has been a fantastic episode of Dose of Dr. Drew. I just reposted on Locals three sites. Speak with an MD is what I use. Mm-hmm. That's $59.99 for the consultation. And then you have to pay extra for the medication. I think I got the medication within 4 or 5 days.
Interesting.
True.
Okay. Interesting.
I also want to promote, where I'm using for psychiatrist right now is a site called Teladoc, teladoc.com.
Do they do COVID management too? Will they do COVID management also?
Yes.
Okay. Teladoc. Yes. All right, good.
And it's nationwide, and they accept medical coverage. So if you live in, I know from New York, you select the state and you select the options, the different options. So I think this is nationwide,
excellent.
This app. So please check out the Teladoc, Teladoc.
Oh, we thought it was T-E-L, not T-E-L-E, T-E-L-A.
Teladoc.
Mm-hmm. Of course I got that wrong.
And then what was the other one that you said? Speak with an MD.
Speak with an MD. That's the one I was talking about earlier, too. We hear good things about that.
There's a third one I've been given. And they also, apparently they might even be faster, but they're more Southwest U.S. generated, but apparently they're just as good as Speak With MD. They're called Synergy Health. SynergyHealthDPC.com. I also am checking
Synergy
the website, as I was waiting on the queue. You may want to post those different Teladoc places on the drdrew.com/COVID website.
Text them to me, Joe. But what was the last one? Synergy Health?
Susan, they're on the Locals page.
Oh, okay.
I reposted on Locals.
All right. We'll add it to the drdrew.com.
So everybody could see them on Locals.
COVID. So what was the last one you said? Synergy Health?
Yeah, DPC.com.
Okay, I'm just texting right now.
And I highly, highly recommend everyone download the Teladoc app.
T-E-L-A.
I'm right now using it to see a psychiatrist.
Great. Joe, what are you going to do going forward?
Very important.
What's your new career?
I'm not going anywhere. I'm staying. I'm going to do what I want to do is I've always wanted to do my own thing with weather. I'm a meteorologist, and I remember when you were on Fox Sports Sunday, you did the weather report, if I'm not mistaken.
Initially.
That's right. I did.
She was the best.
Yes. No, I did.
Yes. I remember that with Fox NFL Sunday.
Yes, it was. It was the NFL pregame show. Yes.
Yes. And so I've been a meteorologist for 17, going on 18 years. Yes.
Well, I just played one on TV. I wasn't a real...
She's a fashionista.
To your point, though, To his point, I want to mention that I do the same thing with my psychiatrist. I talk to them. I've talked to her once every, we were doing once a week. Now we do once every 3 weeks because I'm getting, you know, through things. And it has been a godsend. So yes, thank you for sharing that because it's really important. I think mental health is so, I think, you know, Dr. Drew, we don't even know the long-term effects of COVID truly, right? So it affects you, I think, in all different ways. I have not had COVID, minor other issues, but mental health is so important. Oh, my God.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. We talk a lot about that.
Jillian, yeah. It is screwed. This is, COVID has screwed me up majorly. Hmm. And I've never had COVID. And I so relate to you, and this is why I'm bouncing back and forth on different things, and because of this, and I'm so grateful for both Dr. Drew and Susan Pinsky, and all the locals gang. Please join Dr. Drew's locals. They have been so great, you know, during this very difficult time for all of us. And Drew, please continue to feel better.
Yeah, I'm doing okay. I mean, it's just frustrating, you know. I was looking for a month is enough, thank you. You know what I mean? It's like, well, that'll about do it for
especially for your personality. You've got 50,000 jobs. You work out all the time. I can imagine how frustrating it is.
Very frustrating.
And Drew has said consistently on the program that he wants to help people in the ICU.
Oh yeah. And yeah. Well, so I've signed up in New York and I'm have a meeting at a hospital next week. It's all and if New York doesn't take me, I'll probably do at least vaccines here in Los Angeles somewhere. I'll just volunteer for that. So, all right, thank you, Joe. Mm. Appreciate it as always. And Jillian,
thanks,
that brings
Joe.
Us That brings us to about the end here. We've, believe it or not, filled about an hour and 40 minutes or so.
Yeah, Rex just showed up. He's like, where's my dinner?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I didn't realize that. But I just want to say one thing to Joe's point. Yeah. You and I go way back, 26 years or so. And I just want to add that you are the real deal. I called you out of the blue when I was having a very hard time mentally. And I think that you didn't know me from Adam. And you helped. So he speaks, he speaks truly of you. And I just want to say thank you for having me on. It was such a pleasure.
You need to come back.
I love you guys.
Oh, Susan wants to book you again. We'll need you back.
I want to come back anytime. Are you kidding? I love hanging out with you. Please, anytime. I've got nothing. I do nothing. I've got two kids, two cats, and two dogs. I'm going crazy.
Now your son can go play video
careful,
games again.
Careful what you wish for. Speaking of wishing, I'm looking at the COVID numbers. California is looking a lot better. The national numbers are starting to look better. L.A. County was better yesterday. I don't know if I have an update for today yet. I don't.
Okay.
But Orange County is better. So it looks like things are getting better rather rapidly. So we'll see if it sustains. Yeah. All right, Jillian, thank you for joining me. And we'll see you next time. Susan drags you in here. And
I love you guys. Thank you.
Thank you to Caleb for being behind the scene and operating the engineering of this whole thing, and to his wife for doing the screening. And Susan, thank you for always producing
and for this doing thing. Great sound today.
Yeah.
Without me.
Yeah, sound was good.
Nobody complains about my sound.
Oh yeah, usually people complain about the sound here. Everyone's a potting purist.
I have to go on YouTube and erase all the mean comments. I get it figured out, and at least in the first 5 minutes or so. So.
All right,
well,
guys.
You guys are fantastic. And I adore you both, and I would love to come back anytime.
Okay, Joel, talk soon.
All right.
See you tomorrow. And we'll be in tomorrow at 3 o'clock with...
Yes, tomorrow we have Emily Morris Emily.
Emily Morris coming in.
Bye, guys. She's fantastic.
Yes, she is. Bye, she's a dear friend. Bye.
Love you.